Well, good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. I have apologies from committee member Jackie Bailey, and let me welcome today Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Jobs and Fair Work, and with him are also Chris Stark, Director of Energy and Climate Change, Mary McAllen, Director for Economic Development, and Hugh McAloon, who's the Head of Youth Employment. So welcome to our guests today. The first item on our agenda is a decision by the committee to take item 4 in private. Are we all agreed on that?
Yes.
Right. Thank you very much. And we'll start our evidence session by giving the Cabinet Secretary an opportunity to make a brief, that is, 5-minute statement before we then move into questions. So, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. Delighted to be with you this morning and welcome the chance to give evidence of how, in particular, my portfolio spending helps meet the Government's manifesto commitments. Our aim is to drive progress towards economic and productivity growth and also to create a more competitive and inclusive economy. And as Derek Mackay made clear in the budget last week, this has been done in challenging economic and political circumstances and, I should add, at a time of global economic uncertainty. Between 2010, 2011 and 2019-2020, Tory austerity will see our fiscal departmental expenditure limit budget, which funds discretionary spending and capital investment, fall by more than 9% or £2.9 billion in real terms, with a share of a further £3.5 billion of cuts by 2019-20 still to come. However, this government places the utmost importance on the issues that my portfolio seeks to address. Despite the challenges I've mentioned, my portfolio budget has risen overall in 2017-18, rising to £384.5 million, which is up 4.3% on 2016-17. The emphasis for us remains on the 4 strategic priorities identified in Scotland's economic strategy. That's internationalisation, innovation, investment and inclusive growth, to grow Scotland's economy and to ensure that it remains resilient. Key actions that we'll take to these ends include supporting Scotland's manufacturing base through continued delivery of the Manufacturing Action Plan, and we'll continue our work to develop the business case for a new manufacturing centre of excellence. We've retained funding support for the delivery of the forthcoming Innovation Action Plan, boosting innovation to improve productivity. We will also further deliver the Glasgow Region, Inverness Shire and Highland, and Aberdeen City and Shire City deals. We're also ensuring a continued emphasis on fostering the entrepreneurial culture that encourages everyone to reach their full potential, and that includes activities specifically focused on encouraging greater entrepreneurial activity amongst women. Following the result of the referendum, it's vital that we continue to demonstrate that Scotland continues to be a very attractive location for business growth and inward investment, and we are committed to further funding to establish and embed innovation and investment hubs in London, Brussels, Dublin, and now also in Berlin. We'll also ensure the distinct needs and priorities of Scotland's businesses and investors are reflected in wider training activity by doubling the number of people working for SDI in Europe. All of that integrates with our trade and investment strategy published earlier this year. The First Minister has announced the appointment of Nora Senior as one of the first members of our Board of Trade, and we'll announce the further appointments shortly. This year's budget is the first of a multi-year £500 million investment towards the delivery of our commitment in the Programme for Government to Scotland's Energy Efficiency Programme. The portfolio's contribution is over £27 million for non-domestic energy efficiency and low-carbon heating, a £3 million increase on 2016-17, helping to fund commercial and industrial projects, including pilot projects, district heating and energy efficiency loans. The government's also consistently recognised the sizeable competitive advantages that we have in renewable energy and low-carbon sectors. So in 2017-18, we're raising the level of support for low-carbon demonstrator projects and activity designed to bring an increased number of projects to investor readiness. We will also continue our work in existing areas, including in relation to fair work. We approach the task of creating more inclusive growth and fairer employment by the increased resources being allocated towards that. That's demonstrated by a doubling in funding. And of course, other activities like PACE, which obviously have to be funded when that's been called into action, as we've seen recently in relation to a number of redundancy situations. Beyond that, I'm delighted that we'll fund and deliver a devolved employment support service in Scotland from 1st of April through a transitional employment service for some of the most vulnerable people in society. That's ahead of delivering full employment services in April 2018. We'll also meet our commitment to develop a new programme to specifically support young people who've been in care into appropriate work, training or educational opportunities. And finally, I'm pleased that my portfolio will contribute to the establishment of a flexible workforce development fund, part of a uniquely Scottish response to the introduction of the UK government's apprenticeship levy. Convener, the budget is once again, I believe, a robust plan to deliver on the priorities the government's developed in its economic strategy, and I'm happy to answer any of your questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'll start with a question from Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for coming along this morning. Under the draft budget, based on the SPICE briefing papers we have, the total budget for Scottish Enterprise will be reduced by 33%. Or by 28%, depending on how you look at this number. But overall, the reduction in spending for Scottish Enterprise is approximately £85 million, based on the SPICE briefing. In the notes to the Level 4 figure set out in the budget, you explained that funding for Scottish Enterprise through the draft budget has changed to better reflect the level of planned activities relative to funding and income streams, and the reduction will be negated by Scottish Enterprise reclamation of funding from the European Commission for expenditure associated with delivery of the SME holding fund. Can you explain to the committee, please, what amounts you expect Scottish Enterprise to reclaim through European funding, and will that amount reclaimed, will it make up for the shortfall in direct funding from the Scottish Government?
Yeah, there's a number of different elements to that, if I can say, first of all, and you have more or less the right figure, £84.61 million is the figure I would offer. I would say in recent years, the last 3 years, we've asked Scottish Enterprise to make savings of around £17.3 million through the Strategic Forum. You'll see that in the previous budgets. We haven't asked for that. We've taken that, but we've not asked for that. They've made those savings in each of those 3 years, so that's now embedded. They've also effected a £20 million cut in the capital that's been allocated. They've also cut the amount that we're providing in terms of depreciation. They've cut that by £10 million. And also in relation to the financial transactions money. So within that, the actual grant and aid cut to Scottish Enterprise is about 7.5%, around £11 million. Now, there are, as you've mentioned quite rightly, other sources of capital which will replace much of this. So, for example, the £40 million Small and Medium Enterprises Holding Fund, it should be possible for Scottish Enterprise to access up to £28 million of that potentially, which in turn could leverage around £250 million. And also, I think we would suggest that the other measures which we are taking are also supportive of enterprise, although not directly Scottish Enterprise. So I've mentioned in terms of city deals, I think we've previously provided £30 million to Glasgow. We have nearly the same amount, again, slightly less than that, for the two additional city deals being provided for this year. And we also have provided for task forces. We've also increased the money available for innovation funding by about £2 million. And of course, we've made provision for the Manufacturing Centre of Excellence, £1.65 million for the business plan in the first place. I think the figure on European funding was about 117, but maybe my colleagues can correct that. So it is, I understand, I think the basic point that's been made, it's quite a complicated picture. Money's moving around, and a straightforward cut is not how I'd represent it, given these other aspects. But perhaps my colleagues could maybe would know about that.
I mean, if I could just, on the 117 million, I just wanted to clarify that that's actually about, SE is in a position where it has access, obviously, to grant and aid from the government, but it also has access to a substantial amount of income that it has generated from its own activities, of which this year was an approximate figure is 117.7 million. So that's another factor that's been taken into account in this budget.
Right. Thank you very much for that background. If we look at the totality of all those moving parts, will the budget for Scottish Enterprise increase year on year compared to last year, if you factor into account the sources other than from Scottish Government?
I don't think we can say that at this stage. It would depend. I mentioned, for example, the £28 million. That's a potential figure, and it depends how much is drawn down in relation to that. I think you would see an increase only if you take into account those other things, which are not going through Scottish Enterprises' budget. So in relation to city deals, which I've mentioned, in relation to innovation, that increases the amount, but I think you'll still see a cut in relation to direct grant and aid to Scottish Enterprise.
Thank you. Did you have a concern, Cabinet Secretary, that given the need to stimulate the economy and some of the concerns expressed over Brexit, that we should actually be significantly increasing the budget for Scottish Enterprise? Because for every £1 invested, Scottish Enterprise tell us they get £9 is generated for the benefit of the economy. Is this not a time to be increasing significantly the budgets for Scottish Enterprise? I must add.
Well, I'm not responsible for the HIE budget, but in relation to Scottish Enterprise, I would say, first of all, the budget that we have is around a 5.8% cut this year. It's about an £800,000 cash increase, but a real terms cut of around 5.8%. So we have to live within our means in relation to that. I am confident, I agree with your fundamental point, that in a time when we're facing the pressures of Brexit, we see report after report telling us about, you know, projected fall-off in investment, employment, confidence and so on as well, that we should be stimulating the economy. And I'm confident the other measures I've mentioned, which are not part of Scottish Enterprise's budget. So the city deals, if we want to fund the city deals, I know you're very interested in the Stirling Clackmannanshire one in particular. If we want to fund city deals, we have to find money for those things as well. And that's essentially a further devolution, a resource transfer to local authorities. We should fund innovation as well. It's not part of the Scottish Enterprise budget, but we're increasing the amount we spend in relation to there. The Manufacturing Centre of Excellence is additional money as well. The reduction in business rates is also additional. So, and also, of course, although I appreciate it can be confusing, the relationship between SE and SDI in terms of the finances, there's an increase of around £2.1 million for SDI to fund the additional staff. So I do agree with your basic point. At this time, you want to be investing further in enterprise. Even if it's not Scottish Enterprise per se, I believe we are doing that.
Thank you. And final question, Convener, if I may. It's on a related issue, the Scottish Growth Scheme. I think in one of your answers, might have been a written question, you said that you anticipate the support will mainly be in the form of guarantees, but if appropriate, loans may be offered as well. Do you have an expectation or an approximation of the £500 million scheme? How much will that be in the form of cash and how much will it be in the form of guarantees?
Well, that does depend on the demand that's there. There's work being done, diligence work being done on this just now, both within and those without government, out with government rather, are looking into this just now. But it will be demand-led. It was obviously primarily set up in order to provide guarantees, which was the gap that we'd seen as developing in the market. In fact, it's the same argument I've used to the UK government in relation to the oil industry, where there's been a demand for guarantees for infrastructure development. But we want to remain open to the idea that people may prefer to have loans themselves. So we won't know until that demand. We might have a better idea as the work is done, and I'm happy to keep you updated as to how that's shaping up. But just now, it looks like it'll be demand-led, and we expect the bulk of it to be in terms of guarantees.
Am I right in thinking the budget doesn't have a provision set aside because these are contingent liabilities and therefore they won't appear on the budget until a loss event occurs?
Exactly right, contingent liabilities, so it wouldn't show on these kind of budgets.
Thank you.
Gordon MacDonald.
Convener. There are 28 national performance indicators that are relevant to this committee, 10 where performance has improved, 11 where performance has been maintained, and 7 where performance has worsened. So focusing on the 7 where the position has got worse, it includes GDP growth, exports, research and development spend. What changes would the Scottish Government like to see in enterprise agencies' operating plans and budget priorities to help address those indicators where performance has not improved?
Well, if I can take the enterprise and skills review, which we've obviously announced, that's focusing on things like alignment in particular. So the different agencies which come within the remit of that review, so Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, SDI and Scottish Funding Council, we want to see further alignment, and if you like, hard alignment, whereas up until now it's been alignment by encouragement more. So to achieve that, we have taken the initial step of establishing or announcing that we intend to establish a strategic board. I think also we want to see increased accountability resulting from that, so people being held to account on the measures that you've described for performance in relation to that. GDP, we have had growth, we've got a resilient economy, but it's not touched the levels that we want to see. I think the same is true in terms of productivity, so that's another area. We've seen an increase of around 4.4% in our productivity since 2007. Just by contrast, we've seen the UK flatline in that period, despite which the UK still has higher productivity rates than we do here in Scotland. And most of our competitors in the EU have higher productivity rates than we do, so we want to see productivity increase. And one of the methods, or one of the means by which we can achieve this, is to increase the internationalisation. And so the additional funds which I mentioned in relation to the budget for SDI will be about promoting Scotland, promoting trade from Scotland, initially in relation to SDI, with the increase across the EU, which we think is particularly important at a time of Brexit as well. But obviously we'll be keeping an eye on the rest of the world, India and China as well. So it's really about concentrating on those four eyes. I think we have to acknowledge we've gone through in the last 10 years a very substantial, long-lasting and deep recession. And we now have the uncertainties of Brexit. So these represent challenges which we're determined to overcome by focusing on those areas.
You know, some of the evidence we've received from Scotland's 2020 Climate Group, for instance, when they were focusing on the enterprise agencies, they said there's a need to declutter and simplify the system. I mean, do you think by introducing a board of trade that's actually going to help declutter the system or make it worse?
Well, obviously, we wouldn't be doing it unless we thought it would help, and we think it will help, and it will have a substantial business element to it as well. It will also seek to tap into those sectors which are very important for the Scottish economy to make sure we're as focused as we can be. I think it's right to try and declutter, and I think we do have something of a cluttered landscape. And one of the work streams which phase two of the Enterprise and Skills Review will be precisely that, to see what we don't have to continue doing, as well as the sharper focus on things like trade, which the Board of Trade is seeking to bring. So I think it's right that you review that in any circumstances, but I think it's especially important that you do that in relation to Brexit, to make sure you're as focused as possible, that you have that alignment between the different agencies and actors within Scotland, to make sure, for example, when you're going overseas to represent yourself in markets, you do it in as focused a way as possible. And also you do it by focused, I mean the different agencies involved are working together, but also you do it in such a way as where you're likely to get the maximum benefit as well. So I think the Board of Trade idea is a good one, and I think it will bring a lot of expertise, including very specific business expertise, to what we're trying to do internationally.
Okay, thanks.
If I might just follow up with a question on that, I think in the budget level four figures, an increase is shown for the business liaison and networking budget line, and I think that is related to the trade centres with regard to the hubs in Berlin and so forth. My question is really this: will there be a comparable budget increase for strengthening trade ties with international partners outside of the EU? Is there an identifiable element within the draft budget showing an increase in that area of expenditure?
Not at that level four that we've mentioned, unless Mary wants to correct me on that, but not at that level. We have the existing baseline activity that we're involved in, and we will look to have one-off opportunities. So, for example, we are currently in discussions with the UK government about representation at a major oil event in Kazakhstan. But these things will come up and they will require additional resources. If you want to be part of them, as we were at the ADICEP conference in Abu Dhabi recently. So, no, not at this level. There's not a separate a income stream or budget stream that's going to identify countries out with the EU. And your point is right that the additional resource, the £2 million plus, is specifically identified for what we've previously announced in terms of the hubs and the additional SDI stuff in the EU.
Would you agree that we do need to focus on other countries out with the EU in terms of developing trade, though?
Absolutely. I think that's true, and we've had recent examples. I spoke to around 100 CEOs from India recently, and we have visits by ministers to different countries, China included and so on as well, where we will seek to do that. And you're right to say we can't, obviously, the Scottish Government's not able to strike a trade deal in any event, but there's a great deal of trade promotion that we can do underneath that. In addition to that, what I've said to the Secretary of State for Trade, Liam Fox, is that we are willing to work and are keen to work with the UK Government. The UK Government's got a substantial resource around the world out with the EU in terms of embassies and trade missions, or they have trade missions as well, which we have said, I've said to Liam Fox, let's work together and that we want to take advantage of it. After all, Scottish taxpayers pay into these resources as much as anybody else. So there is a network there. We've also, in addition to that, I should have said, convener, sorry, announced an additional £400,000 to the Chambers of Commerce precisely for that kind of activity, although it will relate both to the EU and to the wider world as well. So, for example, the Chambers of Commerce network is a global one, and if events are being held in countries out with the EU, we can tap into that and try and synchronise our activities with the Chambers of Commerce as well.
But the funding is not dependent on a certain percentage of it being spent by the Chambers of Commerce in non-EU countries?
No, theirs is a global network, so it's not specific to one subset like the EU.
But you would accept that funding or expenditure needs to be directed in that way?
Yeah, and if I didn't, then we wouldn't be considering a substantial investment in, for example, Kazakhstan. We do have to be focused on where we want to see this activity. I mean, the US is a very substantial investor. Germany is a very substantial investor in Scotland and potential for much more. But India, China, the BRIC countries are very important as well. But you've got to pick and choose where you can go. And we're not restricting ourselves to the EU.
Thank you. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. This year's budget is a one-year budget, and it makes it a little bit difficult, and I know times are uncertain, to look any further forward, but what's your view of the budgets on enterprise beyond 1 year?
Well, I think it will depend as ever. Well, actually, I suppose a little bit different next year, and as far as it will depend on our success in bringing the income through income tax powers, which we now have, but it will also depend on UK government a support as well as it does currently. So it's predicated on that. I think it's unlikely that we are going to want to see, certainly in my portfolio, a reduction in the emphasis that we have in terms of enterprise. So whether through the agency, Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, or the other enterprise or business activity that we're undertaking, I think it's probably unlikely we're going to want to downgrade it. But as ever, it will depend on the resources available to us.
But there is an intention, is there, do you know, to publish budgets that look forward more than 1 year?
That'd be Mr. Mackay that would be doing that, not myself.
So you don't know?
No.
Okay, thanks.
No, it's just that I think you moved your head, but it doesn't get into the record. We all have a tendency to do that sort of thing sometimes.
No, it's up to Mr. Mackay. It's not a decision right. I would take.
Thank you. Sorry, Andy Whiteman.
That's fine. Okay, thank you very much. It just makes it a little bit difficult to make an assessment of the increases and decreases in budgets if one's not looking further forward than 1 year. I wonder if I might just revisit the question around the Enterprise and Skills Review. You mentioned in your evidence on the 29th of November that Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Enterprise will remain in law as entities, but they presumably will remain in law somewhat differently than they exist just now. Would, for example, Highlands and Islands Enterprise be able to sue Scottish Enterprise if it wished to? I know it's an unlikely scenario, but if it were to come up that there were some dispute about a piece of land on Arran, or, for example, where there's been both agencies have had liabilities.
I'm never keen to see two agencies of government involved in legal action against each other, but to the extent they're able to do that just now, that wouldn't change, because they would remain, as I've said, in law. They'll both have their own chief executives. They'll both be agencies which are enshrined in law. So I'm not sure whether
they've sued each other previously. It may well be, of course, there's legal proceedings which take place to resolve issues between them, but there's no change to their status, which is proposed, that would have that effect of making it either more or less likely that they would be involved in legal action.
So the strategic board wouldn't make a difference in your view?
Well, the main purpose of the strategic board is that they align their activities. I would hope that would also include discouraging legal action between each other as well, but the purpose is not to limit their powers in that way. The main thing is the alignment we want to see taking place. So, I mean, in relation to the two bodies you've mentioned, I would like to see more collaboration between Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands when it's in their interest to do so, and also when there's a greater interest. So, for example, we have just now just announced the major investment in the smelter at Fort William. Both Scottish Enterprise expertise and Highlands and Islands expertise were used in relation to that, and I want to see much more of that happening.
Just finally, on the increase in number of staff for SDI in Europe, How much thought has been given to the extent to which their effectiveness can be enhanced by collaboration with existing UK efforts, trade delegations and embassies? Or are these designed to be quite standalone?
No, I think, as I said in my previous response, it's been my view that we have to make use of all the resources available to us. I don't think that embassies and other facilities operated by the UK government have been sufficiently open to the Scottish government to use in the past. And I'm very keen that they should be. As I've mentioned, the Scottish taxpayers pay for these as much as anybody else. We saw a recent tweet from, I think, the UK Foreign Office describing the new Queensferry crossing while showing the old, I think it was the railway crossing. So I think we need to be better connected to those. And I, as I've said directly to the Secretary of State for Trade, I want to see that collaboration. The event I mentioned in relation to Kazakhstan would be an expression of that joint working. So I want to see more of it. And the additional staff you mentioned in relation to SDI, of course, they're responsible to this government and this parliament, both the government and the parliament, and their focus is on Scotland's interests. But those interests are served, I believe, by working jointly with others, including the UK government. And you'll find, I think, certainly in relation to the existing SDI staff, there's quite a substantial awareness of what the activity of SDI, and it's not DTI, it's DIT now already, but we want to see that increase.
Okay, thank you.
Just before we move on to another aspect, I just want to ask, Scottish Enterprise has said that it's helped to create 55,000 jobs over the past 4 years, and that for every pound they invest, they get, or £9 comes back. Now, first of all, do you agree with that? And second, if that is correct, is it not the case direct funding should be increased rather than matters dealt with as you've outlined?
Well, I convener, come back to the 2 points I made already. If you have a 5.8% cut, you have to make the resources fit what's available. But I do think it's possible to increase the impact of what we're doing by the other measures that I've mentioned. So, for example, city deals, I think, are important, but they require resources. We also have made, not in my budget, it would be Derek Mackay, in relation to business rates, we've made changes there as well. We also, of course, have to respond to some of the innovation challenges, so there's additional money for that. So you do tend to back what you think will have the biggest impact, and that's what we believe will have the biggest impact. But I think, to answer your other point, that SE have been extremely successful in what they do, and we want to build on that success, but we can do it in a number of different ways.
Thank you. Gillian Martin.
The budget shows that you're focused on putting funding support where there's potential for growth, largely an opportunity. The largest increase in self-employment and business creation is amongst women. Yet Women's Enterprise Scotland has said that self-employed women are currently not well served by the enterprise support. Should more targeted support be available to women setting up in business? And should unleashing the potential of women-led businesses be a priority of the strategic board?
Yes, I think that on that latter point, it certainly should be. I was involved recently in an event at Women's Enterprise Scotland at Glencourse Barracks, or Glencourse. Fortunately, the government's announced they're about to close Glencore's barracks, which they've just spent £60 million on improving. But these were the spouses, and in every case it was, in this particular example, women that were involved in this. And it was quite clear by the work that had been done by Women's Enterprise Scotland that this had not just provided a new opportunity for the women concerned, it had changed things just like their confidence and their ability to engage with the business community. So it was hugely beneficial for a number of reasons, and I think that's hugely important. We know women are further away from the market, if you like, in relation to women's enterprise. So I think it, and given the fact that we have an overarching economic strategy of inclusive economic growth, if you don't have the inclusion, the fullest extent of inclusion of the majority of the population who happen to be women, then you're not going to be achieving your maximum growth in any event. So it's hard to see how the strategic board could be other than very seized of the idea we have to improve and direct support to what we do in relation to women, and that includes women in enterprise.
I mean, just so you mentioned the work that Women Enterprise Scotland did at the barracks with the army spouses. They took a completely different approach to hot housing, talent and creating businesses. Would you say that there's a role for Scottish Enterprise and the board looking at what WES did and adopting some of their practices to improve on the criticisms that WES have made about the support that's been existing already?
Well, I think one of the points of the Education and Skills Review is that not just Scottish Enterprise, but the different agencies should be learning from each other and from others. That is the real purpose of the alignment, this kind of Team Scotland approach. So where you have either best practice or, in this case, new ground being broken, then I think it's extremely important that we have the ability to learn the lessons from that. So I'm sure the strategic board, and perhaps it will be easier for that strategic board to do that than, say, four, possibly even five boards having worked and having to communicate with each other. The strategic board could take that forward. I think it's also worth saying that we are doubling the budget for entrepreneurial activity amongst women. So that money is there. It comes in the innovation and enterprise budgets, or at least that there's new money there, and that can be used towards supporting women. So, but having seen, as I say, firsthand the difference it made to these women's lives, whether or not they went on to establish businesses, the difference in confidence and life experience, and sometimes you'll appreciate there can be a degree of isolation and alienation if you're a military spouse as well. It had huge other benefits as well as those, but it also meant a real change. One woman in particular who did a thing called Treats for Troops, which was packages sent to active personnel in Afghanistan. I asked her what was the most popular element, and she said it without a doubt was Iron Brew. And but bars had not been able to provide her with support, so I managed to get in touch, and the bars have been brilliant and come back with substantial support. So it's an affirming thing in itself that she was able to take advantage of this Women in Enterprise course, but also then to get something as productive and as useful and as rewarding as what she's done. And that is really what an inclusive society is about, I think.
Yeah, thank you.
Andy Whiteman wanted to come in with a short follow-up.
Yes, I'm just, you've mentioned the figure of 5.8% cut twice. Can you clarify what that figure relates to precisely?
That's one of the experts is better than me, but that's what we perceive to be the overall budget, real terms budget decrease. I think there's an £800,000 cash increase on our overall budget, and perhaps Mary or others could say more about that, but that's real terms, which is the only realistic measure. I've heard both in the last Parliament and in this Parliament people talking about cash increases, but in every other context you talk about real terms. It only makes sense when you factor in inflation, even as it is low as it is. So that decrease is in relation to the overall discretionary spending which the Scottish Government has.
Because in the Spice briefing, in terms of the allocation of total managed expenditure, that's up in real terms by 1%. Dell Resources up by 0.7%, Dell Capital's up in real terms by 8.7%, and AME is down by 1.3%.
Well, I have my own figures here which show a 1.8% real terms cumulative change, and 9.2%, certainly was this one relates to the longer period since 2010. Reduction of 9.2% in relation to that, but I'm happy to provide you with the figures in writing that I have, and you can set them aside what Spice have provided, and we can see.
That would be very helpful, Cabinet Secretary, because one of the challenges is in interpreting figures. I'm just wondering, finally, is your figure of 5.8% reflected in the draft budget itself in our table?
In the overall draft budget?
In this document, does the figure of 5.8% appear?
I'm sure that's where I've drawn these figures from, so it should be in there. If not, I would imagine explicitly expressed, but if not, deducible by the other figures. But I'll certainly produce you the figures that I've got, which underlie that 5.8% cut.
Okay, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Richard Leonard.
Another set of figures that we've got from SPICE, and I think Dean Lockhart referred to these at the beginning, are Scottish Enterprise Resource down in 1 year by 17.2%, Scottish Enterprise Capital down 47.7%, Scottish Enterprise Non-Cash down 58%, Scottish Enterprise Financial Transaction down 100%, SE total down 33.2%. Now, I understand you're saying that there are other income streams that Scottish Enterprise can draw upon. There may be some, for the time being, European Union funding that they can draw upon. But those are the figures for the allocation that you've given to Scottish Enterprise, aren't they?
Yes, but if you take two of those last figures that you mentioned, one was financial transactions, one relates to depreciation. This is what is required. This is what Scottish Enterprise need in relation to those figures. The need has changed since last year, so that is reflecting of the need. It's also true to say the first figure you mentioned, the 17.2 million, I think, as I said, that saving's been there each year, but what it was done is it was given to them and then taken back at the end of the year. It's just not been given this year. So it's the same as it was in previous years. But I don't think you can rush by the fact that, in addition to those things, if you're going to fund city deals to the extent that we are, if you're going to fund increased money for innovation, increased money for SDI staff, the money has to come from somewhere. You can't spend the same money twice. And as I've said, in relation to the £20 million cut in capital, which you've also mentioned, there is the opportunity to more than recoup that from other sources. So I think that's, to me, a balanced approach, but it's one that's necessitated by the budget settlement that we have, and we have to live within our means.
Well, I accept that you have to live within your means, but it's pretty clear, isn't it, that you have moved money away from Scottish Enterprise, whether it's to City Deal or whether it's to other activities that you're proposing to embark upon, whether it's SDI or... But you've moved money out, and you're proposing to move money out of Scottish Enterprise.
I have accepted that. I think the most relevant figure would be, in relation to what you're asking, a 7.5% cut, about £11 million in terms of the grant and aid, the money made available to Scottish Enterprise. But it's my view that's more than made up for by the other things which we're doing, which also help enterprise in Scotland. It's not all being done through Scottish Enterprise. It is being done by other means as well. That would also apply. I mean, that benefit doesn't just apply to Scottish Enterprise's area. It's across the country. And it's for, if you like, Scottish Enterprise PLC. So in terms of what Derek Mackay has been able to do in relation to business rates, in terms of the demands we have for task forces, I think the two remaining ones are Fife and West Lothian, which is providing direct assistance. In terms of the increased monies for innovation and enterprise, these are things which would be very related to what Scottish Enterprise does, but the money's not going directly through Scottish Enterprise coffers. So I think this is doing the right thing. It also increases the number of staff available for enterprise more generally. If you look at Scottish Development International, I think that's the right way to approach it. The new staff, for example, in relation to SDI, will be doing things which... there'll be more staff, more to do for SDI, and that represents an increase in resource, an increase in the number of people working on these areas, and I think that's a good thing and the right way to do it. And also, we have, in addition to that, if you remember back to the start of the summer, you've got to think of the baseline from which we're working here. So at the start of the summer, we had the additional £100 million in capital investment announced to try and help with the effects of Brexit as well. So I think there's no question we have a very strong commitment to enterprise in Scotland, but that is not all reducible or reduced to what happens through Scottish Enterprise.
John Mason.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I mean, I suppose to continue the kind of line of thinking, I just wonder, at a kind of wider level, Cabinet Secretary, where we are in the balance between, use the word balance yourself, you know, encouraging inward investment on the one hand, but kind of growing our Scottish companies. And this has come up from a number of witnesses that, on the one hand, would like to grow Scottish companies and they could export more, But on the other hand, I mean, I think we're all pleased that yesterday there's an investment into Lough Aber. How do we get the balance between these kind of two areas?
Hey, I'd probably say that you couldn't point to any one textbook that would tell you exactly what the right balance is. But I think in relation to, you said the phrase, growing Scottish businesses, and that's the real, one of the real challenges that we have. We've got a huge number, a higher number, I think, than ever before in terms of companies in Scotland. But it's the extent to which we can, in the current jargon, scale them up. So we've got some fantastically innovative companies as well, but we, even those which are spun out from university collaborations, but we haven't had the same success in scaling them up. So the growth fund, which I mentioned earlier on, is specifically designed to scale them up. A number of our other activities, I mentioned the four I's, one of which was internationalisation. We also do not export or get involved in international activity to the extent that we have, and I think that's wherever the correct balance lies, it will, I think, include much more internationalisation and much more scaling up. So the demographic of Scottish companies will go from 95, 96, whatever it is, percentage of small and medium enterprises and a very smaller number of large companies. If we can grow the middle of that where companies which are currently successful scale up, and you've got the two unicorns like Skyscanner and Fanjo, we want to see more of those kind of companies coming along. So you're right, that is a challenge. Exactly what the right balance is, I don't know, but I do know we have to do more in terms of internationalisation and scaling up those companies which can grow larger, whether or not, and not all companies want to do that, but whether that's within the Scotland, the UK market, or the international market.
So, I mean, I know we can only look at 1 year at a time, but, I mean, longer term, if we were successful in building up some of these companies, kind of locally based ones, whoever owns them, would that mean that there was less need for inward investment, do you think?
I don't think so. I think we will always continue with our activity to encourage foreign direct investment, not least because, as we saw, as you quite rightly see yesterday, I mean, it's hard to overstate how important that announcement is in terms of a rural economy like Fort William, the guaranteeing of the jobs which are currently there and potentially hugely increased employment in that area. And in a rural area, for that level of an increase in jobs, it is obviously much greater than it was elsewhere. So inward investment is absolutely vital, but it's not just because of the money that comes in or the jobs which are created. It's because it very often brings with it new knowledge as to how to best internationalise. It can be the case that sometimes it comes from countries, for example, Germany, which is more productive, more competitive than we are, and we can learn important lessons from that. And I think that's always going to be important in an open economy.
Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned business rates. I think you'll be aware of the Scottish Retail Consortium report. Has some positive things to say about the government's approach in some areas. But in terms of the large business rate supplement, you may be aware of what they've said in a paper they've issued. They say the Scottish ministers have fumbled the opportunity to comprehensively reverse this year's doubling of the large business rates supplement. And they say that the doubling is emblematic of many problems with rates as a whole. They say little regard paid to trading conditions, changes affecting the industry. They say no consultation or economic impact analysis was done underpinning it, and say that it is at odds with the Scottish Government's Town Centres Action Plan. So I'm just wondering if you can respond to that in relation to what is said there by the SRC.
Yeah, I think I've spoken directly to the SRC. I met with them, I think, two or three weeks ago, and that was one of the issues that they raised. Also said, I think, a number of other things which were quite positive. And obviously the SRC, to the extent that they have within their membership some very large companies, Asda, Tesco, Marks and Sparks and various others, will be very concerned about that particular measure. However, it was quite clear to me from that discussion there's a lot more that concerns them than just that. And what I did agree with them was that we would have a continuing dialogue so that I think, as you've mentioned in your opening remarks, that things didn't take them by surprise, that it was possible to establish a rapport, which means that we have an agreed, and actually I have to say that it related both to UK government and Scottish government. I had a meeting in here with the Scottish Grocers Federation. In fact, I think it's the convenience stores. Gordon MacDonald, I think, convenes that committee. And they made exactly the same point. They felt that if we made a change, if it came on top of just before or just after a UK government change, then the whole wasn't taken into account. So I've agreed to meet further with them. In fact, I offered, in relation to the convenience stores, a very large cross-party group that I would be happy to appear before them with the UK minister so we could explain ourselves separately. So I understand they obviously have that concern. I would say that what we're doing, though, in relation to the small business bonus, including its further extension, and these are really areas, obviously, for Derek Mackay and his budget, I think that has had a huge benefit. So you have to take the thing in the round. I know companies in my constituency who would either have not taken somebody on, would have let somebody go, or may have gone out of business altogether had they had to pay the business rates burden, which they have, which has been taken away, supported, I think, by your own party as well. So I think you have to take it in the round, and we are trying to help those that need it most, and we'll continue the dialogue with the Scottish Retail Consortium.
Do you accept what they say, that 1 in 10 firms in Scotland pays a higher rates bill than elsewhere in the UK as a result of that?
Well, I think it's also true. I mean, many businesses in Scotland pay a lower rate if they get the small business bonus scheme. So that's the point I was making, that you have to take these things in the round, and the greatest support is going to smaller businesses and those in need of it most.
Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Just following that up, I was surprised earlier in the session when I asked a parliamentary question about whether any economic impact assessment has been done on the small business bonus scheme, and I was told that there hadn't been. It's been in place for almost a decade, and yet there's academic evidence that does suggest that when you relieve non-domestic property of rates, very often, if they're owned, the capital value rises, or if they're leased, the rent goes up. So given that you've just cut the general rate poundage by 3.6 pence, what economic analysis has been done to inform whether or not that cut will actually deliver greater levels of economic growth or not, and what economic analysis has been done to suggest that the extension of the small business bonus scheme shall do the same?
On the small business bonus scheme, I think is more properly for me. I'm happy to go away and look at that and see what would be the benefits of doing that. All I can say, and I know it's not a full economic analysis, but it is my experience over the 10 years I've been in the Parliament, that it's been extremely well received. It's been the cause of a number of businesses staying in business, and it's been the cause of increased local employment. So my own experience has been that it's been very beneficial. But I'm happy to look into that. In relation to the other rates, it would be Derek Mackay would have to answer to that. But in relation to the small business bonus scheme, I'm willing to undertake to look at that and come back to Andy Whiteman in due course as to whether there's been sufficient emphasis or whether there's time for us to have a fresh look at what the benefits of it are. Although, as I say, Convener, my direct experience has been that it's been very beneficial for small businesses.
Yes, I think when one speaks to somebody who's had a tax cut, they generally appreciate it. But the job of government is to try and look at that in the round and see whether, in fact, what appears to be a benefit is not in the medium or long term actually negated by higher costs. But I am grateful for your response on that.
Okay, just come back to say, I'm not saying that I've talked to people who said, that's great, you've given me a tax cut. What I'm saying is that they've said they've kept people on. And I know I could actually point to small businesses in my own constituency that have said they've either kept somebody on or they've kept going. I know it seems a bit distant now, but say 4 or 5 years ago, in the teeth of that recession, it was crucially important. And also, because we kept people in employment or helped keep people in employment, it increased or reduced the decrease in the level of demand in the economy. So it's not just people saying, I'm grateful for a tax cut. It's not quite as simple as that. It's an economic development, an economic generation activity, which I think has been beneficial. But I'm happy to look at that and come back to the member. One last thing. The review of business rates, we mentioned rates. It is Derek Mackay's area, but you'll know there is a review of business rates more generally, which is being undertaken by Ken Barclay, which I think reports in the coming months.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Dean Lockhart, and then we move, I think, to a different area with Ash Denham. So, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. It is a brief one. Mr. Brown, your point about the priority to scale up our SMEs, I completely agree with that. I think a lot of commentators agree with that as well. However, the large business supplement, in many ways, we've been told by business, acts as a barrier to scale up, because once a company gets to a certain size, they're punished by the large business supplement in terms of having to pay higher rates. And for many businesses, it's a disincentive to expand. Would you acknowledge that analysis in terms of the LBS being a barrier to the expansion for some companies?
To be honest, I'd like to see the evidence of that. I think large business, such as we tend to be much larger businesses. I think when I was talking previously about scale-ups, I'm talking about small and medium-sized enterprises substantially scaling up from them, and sometimes scaling up would not, for example, require a huge new property or land to be taken. So it had scale-ups in mind more generally, so that the level of activity, the level sometimes of job growth and the level of profit, I think, would also be increased. So I'm not sure it's a disincentive. I mean, I'm happy if you have evidence to send to me about that, to have a look at that. But that's, and as I say, at the same time, as if it was to be the case, and I don't accept it, certainly not having seen the evidence of it, that the large business levy was a disincentive to scale-ups, I think it'd have to be taken in conjunction with the support we're providing for scale-ups. I mentioned the Scottish Growth Scheme. So a number of measures which is going to have a predisposition to looking at towards both tech and scale-up companies, not exclusively. So there is measures and support of companies seeking to scale up, which should be countered against any other interventions like the large business levy that I mentioned.
Ash Denham.
I wanted to take the opportunity to raise with you the quality of Scottish export statistics. It's come up a number of times during our recent inquiry. So Export Stats Scotland, and I quote them, they said the estimates only capture the first point of export. So in my view, that could lead to two effects. One is that some Scottish exports could be being counted as UK exports, but also, as we see with the Rotterdam effect, exports to the UK may be artificially inflated as a result of that. So I suppose my question is, if we're investing in our enterprise agencies to grow our exports, and we're also increasing spend on things like SDI as well to increase our exports, don't we need to be able to accurately assess the impact that we're having with that spending and be able to accurately measure the increase in our exports? So I'm wondering, is the Scottish Government seeking to try and get some improvements in this area?
Yeah, maybe Mary McCallum will want to come in as well, but I think not only do you want to be able to measure and quantify any improvements you make by any intervention that you make, I think we really need to know what's happening now as well. And I think you're right to say the quality of the information is not what it should be. And I've said previously to the committee that I've asked Gary Gillespie, the chief economist and the chief statistician, to look at how we can improve, not just in relation to exports, but right across the piece, whether it's economic or labour market data that we have. It's quite a mixture just now of what we do. So, for example, we'll get stuff provided by the ONS. We'll get stuff which you'll buy or supplement from the ONS. We'll do a Scottish boost. And in some areas, they're completely blank. There may be some areas where we want to have new economic data. Some countries I've mentioned before have a measure called the whole of the economy, which we don't have in Scotland. So I entirely agree with you that we should be looking to improve the quality of the data that we have. And one of the work streams that's been taken forward under phase two of the Enterprise and Skills Review is just that, as I say, underneath the work done by Gary Gillespie and the Chief Statistician to see how we can improve this. But it may be convenient that Mary McCallum want to say more about that.
Well, the only thing I would like to add is that we have put £360,000 pounds in the budget, extra in the budget, to help with some of that work that the Cabinet Secretary refers to.
Okay, and the other thing I wanted to raise was we received a submission from FSB Scotland, you might have seen this already, and they wanted to highlight the importance of getting the maximum economic impact from public spending. So if we are about to embark on a large amount of, you know, capital investment, their point is that breaking down these contracts into smaller projects gives the opportunity for local businesses to benefit from those, and then also that the money from that investment stays in the local economy. So I'm wondering if you'd like to comment on that as well.
Yes, I mean, I agree with them that sometimes you have a sufficient scale of a project that it's not possible to reduce it. So, for example, the Queen's Ferry Crossing is always going to be of the scale that it is. But if you look at the other end of that spectrum, when I was Minister for Transport, we had a number of cycling and walking improvements around the country, National Cycle Network improvements and so on. And these were much smaller project and very importantly, often enabled local organisations to bid for these without having to be part of a consortium or a larger organisation. And that had a disproportionate effect on local economies. As I say, I think there are some larger projects which will require us to have that scale, and there are important economies of scale that we want to achieve. So, for example, on the major projects we've got going just now, partly because of when we undertook those in the economic cycle, we've got extremely keen prices for those. But yes, there's a bigger picture, which is if you can sustain local employment, encourage local businesses by having contracts on a manageable level, then you can actually have a bigger, proportionately a bigger economic impact. So I would agree with that point.
Thank you. Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Just to ask you to follow up, first of all, on a couple of questions from earlier. Given that under the budget we know that certain business and personal taxes will be higher in Scotland, and that could have a negative impact on decisions about investment, about whether businesses, individuals move to Scotland and whether they stay here, I just wonder, what is the Scottish Government doing to offset any such impact on the economy? And what robust evidence do you have that those steps will negate any negative impact?
I do think when we talk about this, and it usually comes under the headline, the highest tax part of the UK, it has to be a real exercise in closing one eye when you say that, if you want to discount the other aspects of, for example, when you mentioned personal taxation, that will be important for people, there's no question of that. But they will also take into account, for example, if they're moving to Scotland, the benefits of free tuition for children going to university and young adults going to university. They'll also take into account even things like the cost of living and the prescription charges. They will also take into account, I would imagine, things like the small business bonus scheme. So I really do think in terms of taxation, you have to take in the whole element, and people and businesses are able to take into account those things. They might not know every detail of every provision, but I think they can take into account those things as well. So I think when we make a judgment on this, for shorthand, if it's about the attractiveness as a place to invest or move to or live in, then people will make a whole series of calculations.
I accept the assertion in what you say, but what evidence do you have that people are making those choices? What empirical data can we point to say when people make that decision, they actively do take in the prescription, the tuition?
I do think it's hard to say what the individual motivations of people are, but I think there are some empirical facts you can point to, which is that we're almost at a record number of people employed in Scotland. We've got a higher population than we've had for many, many years. We've got more businesses in Scotland than we've had for many years. During a time of substantial economic instability and, of course, a downturn in oil and gas, we have a resilient economy which is still growing. Not to the extent I want it to, I accept that. So I think these things can be pointed to as things which endorse the fact that people want to live, work and invest and learn in Scotland. I think these things are all there to be seen.
I just wonder, though, if to go back to Andy Whiteman's point, whether that's something that the Scottish Government ought to be looking into, so that we actually have a direct correlation between cause and effect that we can point to and say there is an actual link between the free prescriptions or the tuition and people making those decisions. Just one other question, specifically on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route. We noticed recently that the timescale for delivery of services on that slipped by 6 months. And so I'm just concerned to know, how confident are you that that timescale will be hit, that we will be having services by winter 2017? What steps you're taking to make sure there won't be any further slippage, and are you comfortable there'll be no cost overrun on that?
That's normally what I report to the Rural Economy Committee on, but happy to answer that. Just to go back, though, first of all, to your first question, the other indicator, of course, would be foreign direct investment, in which we've had some substantial success, according to the Ernst & Young figures produced for 2014 and 2015. So that seems to demonstrate people are willing to invest in Scotland. On the AWPR, it's not the entire project that's now behind schedule. And in fact, the way that contract was let, it was let with the spring 2018 was the timescale the Scottish Government advertised that contract at. The contractor came back and said they intended to do it earlier because it's in their financial interest to do it earlier. So they were going to do the Crabstone Junction in autumn of this year. They actually completed that part of it early in August this year. They were going to do the Balmerie-Tipperty section, which was the subject of the report to the Rural Economy Committee. But that was going to be done by the spring of next year. That will now be until later on next year. And the overall project is still scheduled for winter 2017-18. In terms of, and these things are always subjects, you know, I'm very careful of major projects, especially transport projects. It's the largest project of its kind in the UK just now. So obviously there are contractual or weather issues which can always arise. I accept that. In terms of the cost of it, the cost because of that overrun which you've mentioned will actually, in effect, it will reduce because we only pay for these roads when they become available. Well, it won't be reduced, it'll be almost postponed. We won't start paying for that until we actually have the use of the Balmerie-Tipperty section. So we are paying now for Crabstone Junction, which was earlier. So I suppose you could say that's an increase or an advance in terms of the cost. But the overall project and the roads which are there, it's paid for by a unitary charge, so we don't start paying that until it's completed. So not having that Balmerie-Tipperty section in by the date that the contractor themselves committed to is not going to cost us anything additionally.
Thank you. Gil Patterson, I think, did you want to ask a question about fuel poverty?
Yes, I do. Thanks very much, Convener. Over the last recorded period, just short of 100,000 people have been taken out of fuel poverty. But if you look at the stats, then 50% of that number, although it's extremely welcome, I'm sure we'll all agree about that, but 50% of that is actually due to the reduction in fuel costs. So I wonder what influence the government can have on fuel costs, and do you work with the industry itself, in particular with regards to people who are in fuel poverty who may not have the means when prices are bound to rise again?
It's a very good point, and the member's exactly right. Just over half of the reduction in fuel poverty is attributed to the drop in the price of domestic fuels. Now, having said that, around a third can be attributed to improvements in the energy efficiency performance of the housing stock, and also there's an element of higher household incomes, although they've not increased it a very high rate in recent years. So those things have all had an impact on fuel poverty. And on the member's other point, it's mainly done through my colleague Angela Constance, who holds the vast majority of the budget for this. I think it's about £114 million, where we're in the £20 million a joint. And much of that liaison is conducted through Angela Constance. But perhaps, Chris, we'd want to say a bit more about that.
Yeah, just to say a little more on that programme and those stats, just to confirm, are absolutely correct. There's a number of things that we do that don't involve spending money, I suppose, and they stretch through the year. Most recently, there was a summit actually of the energy companies where we spoke to them about this very issue. We encourage, for example, better switching rates among consumers. And there's another range of things that we do that involve actually intervening in the energy market. So we've helped to set up Our Power, which I know you took evidence on last time, which is there to address some of these needs more directly.
And associated with that, you know, sleeping in the same bed with fuel poverty as poverty itself, and low incomes, low wages, is there anything the government are actively doing to try and really, you know, sort this out of the source, and that's because the people are poor?
Well, I think you'll know as well as I do about the new powers which the Parliament has, and obviously the efforts that we've made in order to reduce unemployment. So that's one factor, and also we have now some responsibility for some in-work benefits as well. But we do believe things like no charges for prescription charges, although many of the people in poverty would have qualified for that in any event, I understand that point. These things are important. But in specifically in relation to fuel poverty, we have introduced the Warm Homes Bill, which hopes to tackle fuel poverty, and consultation on the policy content of that will start in the course of the next year. But I think it's a... it's an issue which every government has wrestled with. I think we've had. I think I'm right in saying, and I would be happy to be corrected on it, that in terms of the levels of poverty, they are less in Scotland than they are in the other countries of the UK. That's poverty generally rather than fuel poverty. But that is still allowing for the fact there are far too many people in poverty. And I suppose it's across a whole range of different government activities, even to the extent of... no tuition fees. It's just trying to increase the life chances of people to get out of poverty, education being one of the main means of doing that. So it is a multifaceted thing.
Thanks for that. Thanks.
Julian Martin.
Short supplementary to Mr. Patterson's question. Fuel poverty rates are higher in rural areas. Can you tell me what's been done to address that in particular?
Well, I can say, first of all, in general, 100,000 fewer households were in fuel poverty in 2015. Now, if it's the case, as you've suggested, that it's proportionately higher in rural areas, then that proportionate reduction should have disproportionately benefited rural areas. But again, I'd maybe ask Chris if you want to say more about that.
No, there are a few things that we do, for example, with the islands, where we look more with schemes that are tailored for that, and there's a programme of work that involves various people, including Highlands Islands Enterprise, actually, who have the broader role. There's nothing particularly in this budget, though, that addresses that issue specifically.
I think it's the case that local authorities will tend to reflect the rurality of their area. So, for example, in the Northern Isles, you'll have district heating schemes, and in the Western Isles, a huge amount of work goes on from the council to try and address this as well. And we do have the proposal for an energy firm as well, which will seek to help to address this too.
Now I can go on to my main question. The existing Homes Alliance last week, when they were in front of us, they called on looking at our welfare powers and the new social security system to address, in part, issues over fuel poverty. Can I ask what discussions there have been at Cabinet about tackling fuel poverty across the portfolios, given that it does impact on quite a few of the portfolios?
Well, there's been a general discussion in relation to that point I raised about the bill which is to be produced. So we discussed these things at Cabinet before it enters the public domain. So there have been discussions led by my colleague Angela Constance.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, there was mention of a figure of 5.8%, I think, earlier on. I just wanted to clarify that. If we look at page 4 of the draft Scottish budget, table 1.02, I think there's a minus 5.8% figure for the 27-18 budget, and the one for 2016-17 is minus 6.8. So I just wondered if you wanted to take the opportunity to clarify comments you'd made about that figure.
The figures I have, convener, I can only go on the figures I've been given. The real terms change on 2010-11 is 5.8%. Now, that does seem different. I think the figure I was providing before was for this year. As that has been said, this is for cumulative since 2010-11. So, apologies for that. We're on a trajectory of 9.2% up to 2019-20. The 5.8% is how far along we've got in relation. Is that right?
It's the...
wants to clarify.
Mr. Brown's correct. I mean, the figures, the 5.8% cumulus is for 17-18. For 16-17, it would be 6.8%.
Right. Thank you.
That's what happens when you try to go to somebody else's portfolio, I think.
Well, I just wanted to give you an opportunity just to clarify that against the figure that we see there in the draft budget. I think Richard Leonard and Andy Whiteman had a further question.
Cabinet Secretary, the existing Homes Alliance also told us last week that they believed a budget of around £190 million this year was needed to deliver a transformational step change, which clearly isn't in the budget. So could you tell us, if not this year, when will we see a transformational step change in the budget spent on energy efficiency?
Well, I believe it is a transformational figure. And, of course, the figure we've committed to is £500 million. And the amount that we expend on that this year is proportionate to that £500 million. That's what we have set out, and we believe we will achieve that. And if you look at the monies which are being allocated this year, let's get the figure therefore in relation to the SEEP programme, it is proportionate to that £500 million. Again, maybe Chris would want to add. So I know that's what has been lobbied for. I realise that. They'd like to see more. We'd like to have more to spend. But what we have to do is make sure that we'll fulfil the commitment we made, which was to £500 million. I don't know if you want to say any more, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, the budget this year commits just over £140 million to energy efficiency measures, which is an uplift on the previous year. And we might add to that some of the wider programmes, including crucially ECO, which is the energy company obligation, which is a tariff on bills, where we work very cooperatively with the energy companies themselves. So there is a very significant sum being spent each year, and there are wider policies too, like the winter fuel payment that are involved in that too. And over the course, we committed in the programme for government to £500 million of spending over the next 4 years. That allows us to develop a programme called the Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme. And as we begin to design that programme for rollout in 2018, there are wider policy measures that we'll bring to bear, not just public spending, but also, for example, the use of regulation to help with some of the objectives here.
And Vinnie, the Existing Homes Alliance are, to use an expression, experts in the field, and they are saying that for a transformational change, this year, a commitment of £190 million was required, and you've committed £140 million. Can I go on then and ask about whether you make any estimate of the financial benefits to other budget areas of the Scottish Government of an increase in expenditure to tackle fuel poverty, especially the NHS, for example?
Chris?
Not directly. So we have done work internal to the Scottish Government on those what we call co-benefits, and they are very big. So one of the reasons for investing in energy efficiency is for those reasons. So there are health benefits, there are wider economic benefits in developing, for example, a local supply chain and those things. And there are benefits to the consumer, of course, in spending less on energy. We haven't budgeted for them here, but that's one of the reasons why when there was a fiscal stimulus package in the current year, we spent on energy efficiency improvements, because we could see those returns. It's a very good use of capital money for that reason.
I think it's also true to say a lot of work has been done in relation to, I suppose, this would be called preventative spend previously as well. But it is also the case that you have to provide those monies up front. The benefit comes subsequently as well. So we have to make provision for this money to achieve these things now. And it is, of course, possible to measure the benefit in future years when the benefit's been experienced.
OK, but you wouldn't consider putting the apparatus of government behind some of that cross-referencing work with other departments in order, presumably, to identify where expenditure can best be targeted?
I'm happy to take that with my colleague and come back to the member of the committee, if you like, convener.
Thank you very much. Andy Whiteman.
Yes, just a brief couple of follow-ups to Richard. I mean, I think what we're struck by in terms of the Existing Homes Alliance evidence is they're talking about a level of investment that's five times what's proposed over this Parliament. And so no doubt we'll return to that. But picking up where Richard Leonard was leading with health, for example, Existing Homes Alliance tell us that if they estimate that if all homes were to achieve a C rating by 2025, that would save the NHS £80 million a year by reducing the incidence of cold-related illnesses. I think what, in terms of scrutinising budgets, what would be useful in future, and I know this is difficult and you've reflected that in your answer to Mr Leonard, is that the Scottish Government has an aim, I think, to increase investment in the NHS by £500 million in real terms by the end of the Parliament. But then, of course, if we can avoid having to do that, that would be very beneficial. And so when we hear evidence from yourself and from others about how spending can help to reduce demands on the NHS, it seems self-evident that at some stage we want to see whether those gains have been, in fact, captured and accounted for, and indeed have they been budgeted for in the health budget going forward.
Yeah, I think the increased demands on the health budget, it may well be if they can be reduced by the kind of investment that's been talked about, but they're much more broad than that, the nature of the increased demands. I think I've responded to Richard Leonard to say I'm happy to look at that. There has been a substantial amount of work done previously by John Swinney in relation to preventative spend. So if you give me the opportunity to check in relation to this particular line, I'm happy to come back to the committee and see if there's any further work that we can do in relation to that.
That's helpful. I think it's fair to say that it wouldn't be just this committee. I mean, in the aftermath of the Christie report and preventative spending, we've heard a lot about that. I think we and other committees will be wanting to scrutinise in much greater detail whether, in fact, that is being followed up, because I... leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you. Liam Kerr.
Just a very quick supplemental on those points about the 140 million. I think you said you were investing in energy efficiency. Just for clarity, that includes non-domestic energy efficiency, which, if I might suggest, would be important to the climate change aspect, but isn't going to address fuel poverty, and it isn't going to raise homes up to EPCC. Is that correct?
That is correct. So it's the total budget for energy efficiency that I'm referring to, and fuel poverty is part of that. In broad terms, Ms. Constance's budget covers the domestic side, and Mr. Brown's budget covers the non-domestic side. But increasingly what we've been doing with the energy budget, as we refer to it, Mr. Brown's budget, is using that as a place to develop SEEP, the Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme, more broadly. And that is a programme that will cover all types of building in the main, has within it fuel poverty objectives, as well as an overall improvement in energy efficiency of the building stock.
Are you able to say, and I appreciate, given what you've just said, this may be difficult, but what was the, if it's 140 million this year, any idea what it was last year?
I haven't got the figures in front of me, but it was a similar figure. So but that figure was, of course, increased by the capital stimulus programme during the year. So including that stimulus package, it's similar to what was spent last year.
Happy to get the exact figure and provide it to you.
If you wouldn't mind, thank you.
Thank you. Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. I'd like to get a brief update on the budget plans and implementation plans for the Scottish Business Development Bank. I believe that was announced earlier this year by Mr. Swinney, and get a brief understanding of the interaction between the Scottish Investment Bank, the Scottish Business Development Bank, the Scottish Growth Scheme, and the new Board of Trade, because getting back to your point, Mr. Brown, about the cluttered landscape, there does seem to be quite a few players out there and agencies out there, so perhaps could you give us an update on the plans for the Scottish Business Development Bank, please?
Yeah, and I'll maybe ask Mary, who's been involved in that work, to say a bit more about that. But just on the interrelationship between, I think, two of the bodies that you mentioned that I caught there, the Board of Trade and the Growth Scheme and the Board of Trade, there's not... an obvious direct correlation there, but of course the work is going to overlap. The Board of Trade will be looking at measures that we can take and the activities that we do undertake to try and increase trade, and that will help inform, I think, where we see demand coming from the Scottish Growth Scheme. On the Growth Scheme and the Business Bank, there's quite a lot of work going on. I think this is reflected in all the parliamentary responses. I've had a number of parliamentary questions, I think, from yourself, but also from Jackie Bailey on this. So there's been, as we've got the information, we've provided that information and the updates. I think the latest information I've given is pretty recent, but it may be that Mary has more she could add at this point.
There are different, you have to, as you, I'm sure you appreciate, there's a segmentation of the market that's actually required to make sure that you are directing the right product to the right place. So we covered earlier the salient aspects of the growth scheme, which is novel, and I think ministers themselves have said is a particular response to a particular set of challenging circumstances, and is about directing funding and whether that be through guarantees or loans, as we previously discussed, to companies who find it very difficult to access sort of pre-revenue, you know, they're at a stage of development which is not particularly attractive to standard lenders, that's a good way to put it. But actually, the companies who tend to be involved in that, they've actually, are particularly requiring that kind of support, are also the companies, as the Cabinet Secretary said earlier, who've got quite a lot of scope, quite a lot of potential. There's also quite a lot of risk around it as well, which is one of the reasons that standard lenders don't really feel that they want to necessarily get involved. The SME cohort in Scotland, I mean, there's evidence, and I can't give you, I can't cite this at the moment, but I'm sure you're aware that there's been work done more or less since the crash in 289, where we can show that SMEs in general have been just less willing to really get involved in accessing bank finance of one sort or another. They've tended to find finance from various other sources, family, their own resources, etc. That's beginning to change a bit. So there's quite a lot of work that's done regularly to look at what do these market segments look like, and what kind of products can you best develop to encourage SMEs to come through and get access to the kind of tailored financing that they require for their particular business model. And the Scottish Investment Bank has been involved in that market for some time. They've taken on some new products that they're pushing. They're very helpful in terms of equity type investment. And what we're trying to get to, frankly, is to have a suite of things that we can deploy for the marketplace and have something that suits everybody's needs. And clearly, some of that is in development, as the Cabinet Secretary said.
Thank you. And just precisely on the Business Development Bank itself, under which agency will that sit? Has that been decided? Who will operate and manage and have oversight of the Scottish Development Bank?
I think we're working most closely with Scottish Enterprise on all of that at the moment.
Okay. Could you, final question, do you have any idea in terms of timing when the plans will be announced in terms of how this will look?
I think it's difficult to be precise at this stage.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, certainly.
There's quite a lot of work going on in this just now, and it's some of it is new ground for us. That's why we've taken in quite a lot of outside opinion and advice. But I'm quite conscious there are a number of members as well that have some experience in this, and we are very open to it's our responsibility to do it, and we will do it. But if there are other suggestions from members, we'd be happy to receive those.
Well, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and also our other guests for coming in today. That's the conclusion of this evidence session. Thank you very much once again for coming in.